Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Our speaker this morning is Father Kenneth Baker, a Jesuit father whom you've seen in the chapel. Good
morning. And the main gospel in the A cycle is Matthew. Then in the B cycle, it's Mark. And the C cycle is Luke. So it's kind of a running commentary. One of the advantages of the new lectionary over the old readings, say of the Latin Mass that we had this morning, is it covers much more of the Bible than the old readings did. People are interested in the Bible like that. But one observer pointed out that one of the consequences of that, having presenting so much of the Bible to the faithful over a three-year period, is it seems that fewer and fewer people know anything about the Bible. In the previous readings from the Latin Mass, you have the same reading, let's say of the talents, on the same Sunday every year. And you listen to that for 30 or 40 years, and pretty soon you're familiar with it. You know, repetition is the mother of studies. Whereas now there's so much scripture thrown at the faithful that a lot of them are not, they really don't know that much about it. All right, so they're called, the first three are called synoptics, which means an overview, a quick view of what? A quick view of the life of Jesus Christ. The life and the works and the teachings of Jesus. The word gospel is like a bird's eye view. The word gospel means good news. It's the translation of a Greek word called euangelium. And let's put this on here. Evangelical, we translate it with a V in English, evangelion. Euangelion is the Greek word. And St. Mark uses that word in the very first verse. So this is the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He mentions it right at the very beginning. The gospel in English means good news. That's what euangelion means. This is good and this is message in Greek. So it's the good news of the message. It's the good news of what? It's the good news of the triumph and the victory of Jesus Christ over sin and Satan and death. That's the good news. Originally, it was attributed to the gospel preaching of the apostles and their followers. That was the good news. Eventually, it became, once you had a number of years where there were no gospels written. After the gospels were written, then the gospels themselves were spoken of, that is the literary text, as gospels. Now, the first writer of the New Testament is St. Paul, who wrote Galatians and 1 and 2 Thessalonians probably around the year 50, 51. Those are some of the earliest writings. There's a debate about exactly when the gospels were written. I'm going to give you a little bit of that this morning. Now this good news is, so this is the triumph of Jesus who's the Savior. And the basic outline on that sheet that I gave you, I'm talking on the first page today where you have these two outlines, which I'll explain. And then I give you an outline of each of the three synoptics. The Gospels run like this, that St. John the Baptist appears at the Jordan, he's preaching. Jesus comes, he's baptized, the Spirit leads him out into the desert, he's tempted. Then he comes in the power of the Spirit, he begins to teach and to perform miracles in Galilee, in the northern part of Galilee. This takes up about the first half of St. Mark's Gospel. Then he goes to Jerusalem to his death. So there's the journey to Jerusalem. You have about 10 chapters in St. Luke about the journey towards Jerusalem. In Jerusalem, he confronts the scribes and Pharisees, who are the leaders of the Jewish people at the time, and he tries to convert them. They reject him. They condemn him to death. Then you have his passion, his death, and resurrection. That's the basic outline of the Synoptic Gospels. Then you have with Matthew and Luke, each of them gives a genealogy of Jesus, tracing him back to Adam, Abraham, and God. And you have the infancy narrative. From Matthew and Luke, which you don't have in Mark or you don't have in John. And both Matthew had his source and Luke had his particular source for that material. All right, so that we consider them the literary influence. We're going to talk about that a little bit first, and then we're going to talk about what the main themes are that run through the Synoptic Gospels. Then tomorrow I'll deal with each of them individually, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, more in detail. Now, when the apostles were preaching, gradually, as some of them were put to death, like St. James, and they got older, the Christians said, we ought to have an account of this written down to preserve for us. And so as a result of that pressure from the early Christians, they began to write down what Jesus said and what he did. The Gospel of St. Matthew is a collection of the teachings and actions of Jesus that's basically in the character of a biography. So a gospel is not exactly a biography, not in the sense that we understand a scientific biography, but it's in that same literary character of a biography. There's preaching in there. So you can call it, it's history, but it's preached history. They're trying to persuade people that Jesus is the Savior. He's the Messiah. He's the fulfillment of all the prophecies in the Old Testament. And if one wants to be saved and attain eternal life, one must have faith in Jesus Christ. One of the characteristics that stands out in St. Matthew's Gospel is that everything Jesus does is the fulfillment of the prophecies of the Old Testament. Right in the first two chapters, three or four or five times, he says, this happened so that the statement of Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled, or as it is written. The reason for that is that Matthew was written for the Jews. Right? And so Christianity is a continuation of the Old Testament, the fulfillment of it. So in order to persuade the Jews that Jesus was the Messiah, Matthew quotes 60 times in his 28 chapters from the Old Testament, about 40 times explicitly and 20 times implicitly. The gospel was probably written in Jerusalem or Antioch, and there's some a variety in the dates. Recent scholarship tends to push it earlier and earlier, all the way back to like up to in around 19, I mean around 43, so be 10 years or so after the death of Jesus. We know from the testimony of the fathers of the church, they say that the Matthew's gospel was written in the Aramaic dialect. And most scholars assume that that means that it was written in Hebrew or written in Aramaic. And generally, they hold that the others were written in Greek. Now, yesterday you heard Jerry Matatic say some hold that they were also written in Hebrew. There are no texts to prove that. That's a theory, that they were written in Hebrew. The general tradition is that they were written in Greek, with the exception of Matthew, that he was probably written in Aramaic and then translated into Greek. Koine Greek was the common Greek of that time. That would be one of the greatest discoveries of scripture studies, you know, of the century, if somebody could find a text of the Hebrew or Aramaic of St. Matthew before it was translated into Greek. That would be a tremendous discovery, like the Dead Sea Scrolls, for example, something like that. Now, St. Luke's Gospel is a two-part narrative. Remember, it's Luke, Acts. The first part is about the deeds of Jesus, and Luke was written for Gentiles, so he plays down the connection with the Old Testament. There are a few Old Testament references, but not like in St. Matthew. He's writing for the Gentiles. We'll see tomorrow, there's certain themes that run through St. Luke's Gospel. And the tradition is that St. Luke, he's mentioned in a couple of St. Paul's letters, that St. Luke was a companion of St. Paul. And so this means that the gospel, in some sense, of Luke is the gospel of St. Paul. Mark is listed as the companion and recorder or translator for St. Peter, and so Mark's gospel is the gospel of St. Peter. Therefore, all four gospels go back ultimately to the apostles. They're apostolic in their origin. So St. Luke was probably written in Caesarea, which is over on the coast of current-day Israel. There's a big mound of dirt there that you can go and visit where the city of Caesarea was, either there or perhaps in Corinth. But an important thing with Luke is he was written for the Gentiles. Now, St. Mark was in Rome, and the tradition holds that St. Mark's gospel was written in Rome. Mark was a companion and recorder, an assistant to St. Peter. He heard him preach over and over and over again. And some of the early tradition states that St. Mark was written while Peter and Paul were preaching in Rome. That would put, as you have in the sheet that I gave you, it would put St. Mark around 60 to 63, something like that. So you have Matthew, let's say, around 43, and St. Luke between 45 and 55, and St. Mark around 62, 63. You'll see later, this is considered heresy with contemporary scripture scholars. What we were taught, all the schools teach the priority of Mark. I'm going to explain about that. This is the two document here, this here. This, in fact, every university or everywhere they teach this, that this is the sequence of the influence of the Gospels, because there's definitely literary influence of the three synoptics on each other. The point is, which one came first, who's influencing who? That's what we want to try. I'm just going to give you a little bit about that so you know something about that. All right, so now we have in the production of the Gospels three stages. Those of you who are taking notes, three stages. The first stage is the life and deeds and actions of Jesus himself. That's the basis of it. Remember, he had those two beautiful pyramids here yesterday of the Torah as the basis of the Old Testament. The first five books of the Old Testament, the Gospels, the four Gospels, are the foundation of the revelation in the Christian dispensation, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So if the deeds and words and acts of Jesus are the basic, then the second stage is the memory of this and the preaching of it by the apostles and their assistants and those who came after them. They're called sub-apostolic or apostolic men like Mark and Luke, who were associated with apostles. And remember now that when we have these readings in the liturgy during this time, Jesus is constantly saying, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit to you, the Spirit of truth. And he will call to your minds everything that I said to you. This is all divine revelation. All divine revelation. It's not something that is produced by man, because, like the modernists would say, man's, you know, a reaction experience of God. The Catholic understanding is this comes from God. It's revealed by God. Revelation. And inspiration. Theologians are still debating on the precise meaning of inspiration. That the doctrinal development of inspiration is not over with yet, what that means. Now, there's a strong consensus of synoptic scholars of all stripes, literary, of liberal, conservative, that a literary relationship exists among the synoptic gospels. And this conclusion is based on the striking agreements that exist between the three synoptics, both in the wording of the word they use here is pericopes, means a little story. It's a Greek word, means a little story, incident in the life of Jesus. And in the sequence in which these pericopes are reported, the same events in the same series, in almost the same words in the three Gospels. They have books produced in Greek and Latin and English in parallel columns of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and you can see where the wording is exactly the same, whether in Greek or in Latin or in English. They're very useful for studying the Synoptic Gospels. So there's for example, that beautiful story in the beginning of Mark's Gospel, the second chapter. I love that one where they want to get to Jesus, but there's so many people around them, they can't get in the room. They go up on the roof, and they take the tiles off the roof, and they let this man down with ropes. And Jesus tells him his sins are forgiven, and the Pharisees are scandalized, said, who can do that except God alone? And Jesus says, nor that you may know that I have power, to forgive sins. He turns to him and he says, take up your bed and walk. And the guy gets up and walks out. Now that that incident is in all three Gospels in pretty much the same words, even the sentence of Jesus, which is called an anakaluthon. He doesn't finish the sentence. In order that you may know, then he turns to him and says, you know, take up your bed and walk. That's the same in all three. And then the two events that come after that, the conversion of Matthew and the question about fasting, are all in the same sequence in the three Gospels. There's no reason why that would be if they were all writing independently, but they put those three together. Those are little indications that what we're talking about, that there's a literary relationship between these three Gospels. Now, I'm going to give you three attempts to explain this. The first one, and the simplest one, is that the three Gospels were written on the basis of an oral tradition. That there was an oral tradition. They were good at memory in those days. They memorized things. You read some of the fathers of the church too, I think it was St. Gregory Nazianzus, I think, who memorized the whole New Testament. Of course, he spoke Greek. He memorized the whole New Testament. And there are many instances of people like that have been able to, you know, memorize the whole Quran and things like that. So they had, since they didn't have all the printed materials that we have, their tendency was to memorize things. So they remembered things. And one tradition is that there was an oral tradition. All three evangelists made use of the same oral tradition. That explains the similarities between them. But each of them varied a little bit because he had different traditions, and that would explain the disagreements, the agreements and disagreements. The two main theories of this are called the two gospel hypothesis here, and that's the two document hypothesis that I put that up there. I hope a little more clearly than Professor Rice did yesterday. I had that in mind when I was putting this up here. Of course, he wrote without even looking. I can't do that. So that's the first. Now, so the two. Let's take the two document hypothesis, the two gospel hypothesis. Let's take the two document hypothesis. This is the ruling the roost today. This is dogma. And anybody who, probably if you were in a university and you were teaching there and you didn't have tenure and you didn't teach that, you'd probably be fired. I mean, it's considered dogma, this one. When I was in graduate school, this is what we were taught. This is the two document hypothesis. All right, now, the assumption that Mark was written first. Okay, the whole tradition of the Catholic Church says, the fathers of the church say, Matthew was written first. But the German scholars, starting in the 18th century, figured from literary criticism, internal criticism, they didn't pay any attention to the tradition, going back to the fathers of the church. They said, no, Mark is the most primitive gospel. It's the shortest, it's rather blunt, the language is not very sophisticated the way it is in Luke and Matthew. And there, in those days you had, especially in the 19th century with Hegel and Darwin, you have these ideas of evolution going from the less perfect to the more perfect. So behind this is the idea that Mark is like an uncut diamond. Therefore he must be first. Okay? Another reason that they give is there are 60 verses in Mark and 1,065 in Matthew, something like that. Almost all the verses of Mark are in Matthew and Luke. So they say Matthew and Luke just took over Mark. Because many of the sequences are in the same order. So here's Mark. They say Matthew and Luke independently. They didn't know what the other was doing. Matthew did it over in Palestine, and Luke did it maybe over in Greece. They both copied Mark. Now, you have large sections of agreement between Matthew and Luke of material that's not in Mark. Where did that come from? There's material that's not in Mark, like the woes to the scribes and Pharisees, for example. That's not in Mark. And the Sermon on the Mount is not in Mark. Aha! Aha! There had to be another document that they both had access to. And that is the famous the mysterious Q. Q. Q stands for Quella.
For those of you who know German. Quella. Quella equals source.
Okay, that's the famous Q. So that explains, Q explains why there are the Sermon on the Mount and the woes are in Matthew and Luke, but they're not in Mark. So they had these two documents. Luke says at the beginning of his gospel that he did research. He had documents that he worked on. Now, what about those things that are peculiar to Matthew that are not in Mark or Luke, and those things in Luke that are not in Matthew and Mark? So you have to have a special source for Luke, the first two chapters. You know, about the Annunciation of the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Magnificat, the Benedictus, and so forth that we said this morning in the morning prayer. That comes from what they call L. Luke, that's a special source of Luke. And also the appearances in the 24th chapter of Jesus after his resurrection. There's very little of that in Mark. Very little of that in Mark. Same thing for Matthew. Matthew's first two chapters on the infancy narrative are different from Luke's. So he must have had a different source. So they call that M. M, right? That's M. And this is Q, and then this is L. So now, the theory then is that Mark was written before the fall of Jerusalem, probably. Someone put it later. Matthew around 85, and Luke around the same time. The tendency is to put these Gospels as far away from the apostles as you can. That they were not, they maintained they were not written by the apostles. Remember yesterday, Jerry Matatix was talking about the creative community that created the speeches of Jesus in the Last Supper in St. John's Gospel. They talk about this creative community, that these documents were produced by different communities. One may say in Antioch, one in Corinth, or something like that. This is a scholarly theory, assumption. There's no evidence for that anywhere. There's no evidence for that. So that's called the two-document hypothesis, or the two-document theory. I'll try to answer any questions that you might have about that. But that's trying to explain the literary connection between, this has got nothing to do with understanding the Gospels, by the way. Nothing to do with that. This is called source criticism. And by the way, in this book that I did, you won't find any of that. I find this stuff a waste of time. So, each scholar, they all disagree with each other. They all disagree with each other. What came from Q, for example, or what didn't come from Q. One time I heard this story a couple of years ago, you know, the famous Father Ray Brown, the scripture scholar. He died, I think, two summers ago. And he said he goes up to the pearly gates and he knocks on the door, and out comes St. Peter. And, oh, he says, Father Brown, man. He says, yes, I see you. We're glad to have you. And Father Brown says, well, I want to get into heaven. And Peter says, oh, fine. He said, checks the list. Yes, Father Brown, you've made it. But there's one problem. He says, you're going to have to go to purgatory for a while. And Father Brown says, well, how long do I have to stay in purgatory? And Peter says, well, you can get out of purgatory when you can provide us with a copy of Q. And it's that kind of scholarship that has removed scripture study from ordinary people. Ordinary people, they can't follow that. You know, so it makes it very arcane, as if it's something just for the university. And the Gospels are written by the church for the church. They don't belong to the university. They belong to the church and the faithful. That's what they belong to. They don't belong to the university. The university can study them there, but the only authentic interpreter of the meaning of Scripture is the magisterium of the church. All right, now, the two gospel hypothesis is coming into vogue at the present time. Last year I recommended a book to you that I want to recommend again, edited by Professor William Farmer, another one of these Protestant evangelicals who converted to Catholicism. And he edited this book from Liturgical Press called The International Bible Commentary. The only thing is, it costs about $100. It's 2,200 pages. It's a commentary on every book of the Bible. I was astonished to get this, even from liturgical press up in Minnesota, of all places, that they don't, these international scholars, really international, India, Sri Lanka, Germany, Russia, everywhere, that they don't hold this. This is astonishing for a book like that. They don't hold this. They hold this, the two gospel hypothesis. Now, the two gospel hypothesis runs like this. It's based more on the tradition of the church that Matthew, probably written in Hebrew or Aramaic, was the first gospel. That makes sense, that the one in coming out of Jerusalem in Hebrew for the Jews would be the first gospel. My professor at Innsbruck, Father Paul Gechter, he was a famous scripture scholar, he always maintained that Matthew was written around 43, about 10, 13 years, something like that, after the death of Jesus. So this theory, they're all theories, none of them are proved. These are all just theories, right? Hypothesis. This is Matthew's first, okay? And Luke is second. Matthew was written for the Jews. Luke was a companion of Paul, and it was spread around, it was used, they found it difficult to use Matthew to convert Gentiles because of the strong reference to the Old Testament, and the Gentiles didn't know the Old Testament. They didn't revere the prophets. They didn't know anything about that. That's Jewish history, Jewish religion. So they needed a gospel that would be directed more to Gentiles with less emphasis on the Old Testament. This was the gospel of St. Paul because Paul was, well, he was the apostle of the Gentiles. And so St. Luke then, using Matthew, incorporated a lot of Matthew into his gospel, but he had many things that he got elsewhere. That's the, like the first two chapters and the appearance stories. There you have things like the prodigal son, the good Samaritan, Lazarus and Dives. These stories, they're not anywhere else. They're only in Luke. So he had other sources. But basically the sequence that he follows that I gave you at the beginning is the same as Matthew, and many of the stories follow in the sequence of Matthew. So Matthew would be 43, Luke around, let's say, 55, 57, somewhere like that. So then Mark had both Matthew and Luke. And this one emphasized the gospel for the circumcision and the problems with, you know, when you become a Christian, do you have to become a Jew? The strong emphasis on the Jewish tradition. Whereas this one of Luke was written for Gentiles, for the uncircumcised. The uncircumcised. So you have these two groups that as they reach the stage when both Peter and Paul were leaving the scene, they're both, you know, to either die or to be put to death as martyrs, there needed to be some kind of a reconciliation or link between the two of them, and that's what Mark was done. Mark was done in Rome, around the early 60s, while Peter and Paul were still in Rome. You go to St. Peter's in Rome today, and you walk up to that magnificent basilica, you see two heroic statues there. One on the left, one on the right. Many of you have probably been to Rome. Right? One on the left, holding the keys, is St. Peter. It's about 18 feet high. On the right is St. Paul holding a sword. And one of our professors, who was a canon law professor, you know, this was before Vatican II, there was a tendency, Americans tend to be kind of legalistic. Everything Rome said they wanted to do, whereas the Europeans weren't all that, moved by that. And Peter's fingers pointing down like that. And so Father Heinzel, he said that one interpretation of that is, it's like you have here with the, you know, with Moses with his finger. Yeah, same idea, the fingers pointing down like that. He said one interpretation is, the laws of the church are made here in Rome. But Paul is pointing out like that. And he said, but Paul is saying, yes, but they're observed out there. Over there. See, so it kind of, its own way, it brings out the difference between Luke and Matthew. Luke representing the Gentile view, and Mark representing St. Peter as kind of reconciliation, a link or a bridge between these two Gospels, using those things that are common from them. We've got to see what's common, what's Mark, Jesus presented in Mark as a wonder worker, an actor, and a doer. He's not much of a preacher. And there's very, very few words of Jesus in sermons in St. Mark's Gospel. Whereas in Luke and in Matthew, you have long sermons of Jesus. Take the Sermon on the Mount, chapters 5, 6, and 7, for example, in St. Matthew's Gospel. So those are the two basic theories then. And the one I adhere to is this one here. This is more in accordance with the tradition of the church. Now, some of the reasons for holding, I just want to give you a few of the reasons for holding the two gospel hypothesis here. First of all, the agreement in the relative order of the pericopes among the synoptics is explained by the second writer having frequently preserved the order of the first. That is, Luke preserved the order of Matthew, and the third, namely Mark, having followed the order common to his sources. That is, where they agreed with one another, and having followed the order of either the one or the other, where they departed from one another. Secondly, granting that the Jesus movement was Jewish in origin, it is both right and natural that the most Jewish of the Gospels be recognized as foundational for the development of the Christian faith, bringing together both the law and the prophets with God's self-revelation in Jesus Christ. That's Matthew. In the writers of the first century, Matthew was quoted far more often than any of the other Gospels. You take the Eastern Fathers, the Basils, the Gregories, St. John Chrysostom, and so forth. Matthew is the one that they quote. With Luke coming in second, John third, and Mark, our shortest text, hardly quoted at all by any of the fathers of the church. A very significant point, seems to me, that if Mark were first, why would he be the least quoted by the fathers of the church? So this pattern of quotes supports our view that Matthew was from the beginning regarded as the church's basic or foundational gospel. Thirdly, if we examine the Greek text of the Gospels, we discover many signs of careful use by the later writers of the earlier Gospels. Phrases, for example, that are favorites of Matthew tend to reappear in Luke and Mark, but not vice versa. The same is true of Luke. Luke's favorite words and phrases tend to appear in Mark, but not in Matthew. And consistent with his being in the second position. And finally, Mark's characteristic words and grammatical constructions are found in neither Matthew nor Luke, consistent with his having been written last of all. And fourthly, which I think is very important, the evidence from the church fathers supports the hypothesis that Matthew and Luke were written first. For example, Eusebius, church historian, first part of the fourth century, around 300, 325, quotes Clement of Alexandria, 180 after Christ, quote, "Those were written first which include genealogies," end of quote, namely Matthew and Luke. So that was at 180, year 180, that's what Clement of Alexandria said. Now some of the benefits of this theory are first of all, in contrast to other schemes, this approach to the gospel sticks to the canonical writings themselves and attempts to understand them without recourse to hypothetical sources. You don't have to go to Q in order to understand the gospels. This means that scholar and pastor start from the same place. That situation is not helped when scholars, without providing their readers convincing reasons, take as their starting point for interpreting the Gospels a complex and arcane theory that can only baffle most intelligent laypersons because it involves the use of hypothetical texts only the scholars themselves know anything about. And one of the things that's disturbing about this German scholarship is they just brush aside the whole tradition of the church. Eusebius, Papias, Justin Martyr, Clement of Alexander, Origen, Tertullian. They're literally, this of course it comes out of a period of rationalism, right? Rationalism, beginning in the middle of the 18th century, especially the 19th century, human reason is superior over everything. That's part of the background of that. Also, in Matthew, Old Testament passages are explicitly quoted, sometimes by Jesus himself, more than 60 times. So this gospel is the bridge between the Old Testament and the good news of Jesus Christ. So there you have this notion that Matthew is kind of like the link or the bridge showing the connection between the Old Testament and the New Testament. Jesus is the servant. He's the suffering servant. He's the Messiah. He's the Son of God. He's the Son of Abraham. He's the Son of David. And there are something like 50 different titles of Jesus in the Gospels. I remember when I was in graduate school, there was a book by somebody, my name Taylor was his name. I forget the first name. But it was the names of Jesus, and he had about 50 different titles of Jesus that are used in the New Testament. Okay, now with regard to the two-document hypothesis, what are some of the consequences of this one over here? Two-document hypothesis. Some of the consequences. First, the assumption is Mark is the earliest of the three synoptic gospels and the shortest. It has a rather rough style characterized by excessive use of certain adverbs. For example, he uses the word immediately 40 times in 16 chapters. And he uses the word again, over and over and over again. Then he'll say and. That when you analyze it from a literary point of view, it's rather a rough style. It's like reading papers written by freshmen in college. If they can even spell it right. There's certain redundancies, the use of the historical present, and dramatic, if not verbose, narrative style. Now, none of these is necessarily an indication of Mark's originality, but on the assumption of Mark and priority, it's not difficult to understand why Matthew and Luke variously eliminated or modified many of these features. So those who hold the two-document thesis say, well, they cleaned it up. When they took from Mark, they got rid of the immediately, and they used subordinate clauses, and they used a more sophisticated kind of language. They cleaned up the rough edges of Mark's gospel. Secondly, both Matthew and Luke rewrote Mark. Right, that's the two-document hypothesis. Improving Mark's style, omitting Markan elements that might be misunderstood or that were theologically objectionable. Now, Mark is very rough on the disciples. They don't understand Jesus at all. Peter is treated very severely. And that's one of the proofs that they think that why Mark was the companion of St. Peter, because the humility of St. Peter after having denied our Lord three times and abandoned him in the Garden of Gethsemane and so forth, that he repented of that and wept over that, so that when he preached, he was kind of hard on himself. And that's represented in St. Mark's gospel. Next, both Matthew and Luke independently supplemented Mark's account by means of the common materials, mostly sayings, that they had from Q and from other stories and sayings circulating within their respective churches. Also, similarities and differences between Matthew and Luke come from Q and then their own sources, M and L. That explains the similarities and the differences between Matthew, where they agree with Mark and where they disagree with Mark. Now, the two-document hypothesis does not necessarily imply that all that was added by Matthew and Luke were secondary creations by the evangelists. In accordance with the principles of redaction criticism, those critics who adopt the two-document hypothesis normally assume that much of the variation that exists among the Gospels is a reflection of the different ecclesial communities to which the Gospels were originally addressed. Still, The two-document hypothesis also implies a measure of theological development, this idea of evolution from the more simple to the more complex. There's a kind of a Darwinian dimension to this, you know, evolving up. That's related to Hegelianism and especially Darwinism in the middle of the 19th century. So that kind of gives you an idea of this is called source criticism. And when you're in graduate school, you spend a lot of time on this. It doesn't help your spiritual life very much, I'll tell you that. No questions now. Save your question till then. It doesn't help your spiritual life. But this gives jobs to professors at the university that come up with this kind of stuff. But you know, one of the problems we have with scripture study is the church has lost control of the Bible to a certain extent. That is, it's studied by all in these universities in Germany and the United States and France, and the magisterium has no control over that. That's one of the reasons why we have ex corde ecclesiae. The church wants to start to assert some kind of control over the study of the basics of the faith, at least in Catholic universities, requiring that professors who teach this stuff have to have a mandate from the local bishop. They have to have some connection with the magisterium of the church before they can get involved in teaching scripture or dogma or things like that. And as you probably know, how much the educational establishment in this country has resisted that. For 10 years, they're still debating, whether or not this applies to the United States. Anyway, you can read all about that in Dossier magazine this month. The final thing before we get some questions is some of the common themes. We're going to go through this, and we'll treat this again tomorrow. Some common themes running through the three synoptics. Now, we're leaving John aside. The three synoptics stress to a great extent the humanity of Jesus. That's the humanity of Jesus. He lived at a certain place at a certain time. He come from this family. He speaks this language. We know exactly where he was born, where he lived. All of that. That's the human dimension. Whereas St. John, symbolized by the eagle flying high, St. John stresses the divinity of Christ, the signs that he worked. The strong emphasis on the divinity of Christ. So in order to understand the New Testament, you have to take a certain leap in time. It's language. It was written in Greek, which today people don't speak anymore. And even the people in Greece don't speak the kind of Greek that's in the New Testament. Modern Greek is not like ancient Greek. Then you have a difference of geography. We're in the New World. That's the Old World, the cradle of civilization. So you have a difference in language. You have a difference in geography. A difference in time. The whole mindset 2,000 years ago is very different from the way we think. Now, certain motifs that run through the evangelists, the synoptics. First one is there's a new order. Jesus Christ means that there's a new order. St. Paul expresses that by you are a new creation. All history is divided between what comes before Christ and what becomes after Christ. So we're in this beginning of the third millennium, right? It's 2,000 years since the birth of Jesus Christ. So something new has entered into the world through the birth and life and death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus says that he's greater than the temple, and the temple is where God dwelt. That he's master of the Sabbath, established by God as time to worship. That he's greater than Jonah. That he's greater than Solomon, the wise king. These are various indications of his divinity and of his origin. So in the ministry of Jesus, the people are confronted with something totally new. He says, John the Baptist was a great man. But the very least in the kingdom of God is greater than John the Baptist. So John the Baptist kind of straddles the Old Testament and the New Testament, like a bridge, something like that. That he's the crossover. He's got one foot in the Old Testament, one foot in the New Testament. His job is to point out Jesus as the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. So there's this new order. Secondly, the gospel is the history of Jesus is called, it's preached history, it's called gospel or good news, and the emphasis on all three synoptics is the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God, or the reign of God. The problem with English, in the English language, kingdom, we might think of as the territory. But it doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean, it's not a territorial term. It's not a geographical term. It means the reign or the rule of God over the hearts of men. That's the kingdom of God. That's extremely important in all the Gospels. And the Synoptics, then they refer to this new order as the kingdom of God or the reign of God or the rule of God. And this concept is central for understanding the Synoptic Gospels. It's summarized in Mark 1, 14 and 15, right at the very beginning, excuse me, of St. Mark's Gospel. Quote, "After John had been arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God." Quote, this is Jesus now, "The time has come. The kingdom of God is upon you. Repent and believe the gospel." The time has come. Some translations say the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God has come to you in Jesus, in himself. Repent of your sins and believe in the gospel. Now, this is all very Jewish. This is using Hebrew terminology from the Old Testament. It indicates the coming of God in a new way into dealing with his people. It's a judgment on Israel and the establishment of something totally new, and that's the church. That's the church, the community with the body of Christ. It's Matthew's gospel that stresses the notion of the church. There you have the name of the church mentioned twice. It's not in the other gospels at all. It's sometimes called the gospel of the church. That when he promises the keys of the kingdom of heaven to Peter, and whose sins you shall forgive, they are forgiven. Whose sins you shall retain, they are retained, and so forth. Now, the people of the time expected the Messiah to be, as you know, a liberator, military leader, somebody that would free them from the Romans, free them from oppression. When Jesus came preaching the good news and the gospel of the kingdom, many people rejected him because his mission was a spiritual mission of repentance for sin. And he came as a Messiah who's a suffering Messiah in the terms of Isaiah 52 and 53. One of the themes that we'll see tomorrow that runs through St. Mark's Gospel is called the Messianic Secret. Jesus always prohibits anybody from announcing that he's the Messiah. And the reason for that is they understood by the Messiah a military leader, a political leader who would liberate them from the Romans. Whereas Jesus did not come as that kind of a liberator. He came as one who frees them from sin and the power of Satan and the power of death. So they had a false notion of what the Messiah was, and Jesus tried to correct that. Look how difficult it was for him even to get his disciples to understand it. Even after the resurrection, in the first few verses of the Acts of the Apostles, about the time of his assumption, the apostles say, "Is it now that you're going to restore the glory and the kingdom to Israel?" I mean, even at that point, this is before they had received the Holy Spirit on Pentecost, they still didn't get it. You know, so that shows you the difficulty that he had of trying to communicate the kind of Messiah he was. Another point that runs through the Synoptics is this notion of fulfillment, promise and fulfillment. So you have all these quotes, especially in Matthew, but also in Luke and Mark on a smaller degree, according to the scriptures or as it is written, so that the presence of Jesus is seen as the fulfillment of all the prophecies of the Old Testament. One book I consulted on this pointed out, I didn't count it myself, said that there are 360 references to the Old Testament in the New Testament. 360. That's one for each day almost. The references to the Old Testament. Another point too is that belief in Jesus as the Messiah determined how the apostles and the first disciples used the Old Testament. It was not the Old Testament that determined their understanding of Jesus or formed their conception of the Messiah. These unbelieving scripture scholars will say that these early communities took these various prophecies from the Old Testament and then concocted the words that put in Jesus' mouth because Jesus didn't say any of those things. Have you ever heard this Jesus seminar? Where they meet once a year and they all get these little round red balls and gray balls and so forth, and they toss them and see what statements that are attributed to Jesus did he really say? And when you get through with it, there's practically nothing that's in the New Testament that Jesus actually said. He might have called himself Son of Man and a few things like that. This type of thing is very destructive of faith. It's destroyed in the last 30 years the faith of many priests and nuns who have gone to these schools and studied scripture under these terms. Once you kind of start thinking about, well, Jesus didn't say any of these things. It was all made up by man, so it's all man-made. You know, it's not really true. It's not revealed by God. So it's destructive of faith. He's the Messiah, which means that he's the fulfillment of all, like Moses, he's the teacher, fulfillment of the Old Testament, but of a suffering Messiah who is the Son of God. And then they stress that he's the son of Abraham, he's the son of God, he's the son of David, and the son of man. Jesus takes this statement from Daniel and Ezekiel and gives it new meaning based upon the prophecies of the Old Testament, especially Isaiah. Finally, Jesus says in Matthew 5:48, "Be you therefore perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect." One of the things, as I mentioned in my homily this morning, that stands out in the New Testament religion is it's primarily something interior. It's a change of heart. It's a religion of love, love of God and love of neighbor, manifested in the eight Beatitudes. Love of God and love of neighbor. It involves keeping the Ten Commandments, yes, but you know, it's not something just external. It has to be internal. It has to be internalized in order to be real, so that one can really grow in the knowledge and love of God and approach the fullness of this new creature that St. Paul speaks about. So I think I'll conclude with that, and then we're going to have a little break and maybe some questions. Okay.